Venice Beach Fitness Improvement District Board of Directors meeting. First, I'd like to introduce myself. I'm Mark Sokol, the president, and why don't we take it from Connie and give a few introductions?
I'm Connie Brooks. I've been a Venice resident for 23 years. I'm a property owner at Hampton and Sunset area.
Jay Goodfader. My family owns the Sidewalk Cafe. Grew up in Venice, still living in Venice.
Tara Devine, CEO of BID.
Steve Human, treasurer of BID.
Marcus Sleeper from Armagino, and I'm handling the finances of Venice District.
Good morning, everyone. Thank you for coming. I'm Matt Moore, and my family owns and operates Venice Beach Suites and Hotel.
Jack Hoffman, resident property owner.
Thanks, everybody. Next item on the agenda today is public comment. This is for non-agenda subjects. And first, I'd like to call Shannon Lewis.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Shannon Lewis. I'm a field deputy for Supervisor Sheila Kuhl. I just started in her West Metro office. So I wanted to come by and introduce myself and familiarize yourselves as well as myself with you all, and let you know that I'll be attending these meetings and I'll be your point of contact for this. I have some cards here, and if there's ever any questions or anything that I can help you out with, please do not hesitate to contact me.
Thank you very much. In the same governmental vein, I'd also like to introduce Taylor Baisley from the council office.
Hi, friends.
Thanks for coming out today. Okay. Jim Urez.
Hi. Jim Urez, longtime Venice resident. A couple of three quick comments. Street cleaning occurs within the bid and during the time when you have people out walking and cleaning the streets. I praise you for cleaning the streets. It's very awesome. But they don't need to do it 10 minutes before the street sweepers go out. It's a waste of manpower and it's a waste of resources. I think you should probably schedule the days that they do their street sweeping that they only clean the sidewalks when the sign says Monday or Tuesday street sweeping. And let them only clean the sidewalks, push the dirt into the street, and let the street sweepers pick up everything, because we're paying for that too. That's the first comment. Graffiti on Main, and it travels around to Hampton where Brooks is. That's all part of the bid. And walking here, there was at least four tags between Main and Brooks and here, and that stuff should be cleaned as often as the streets are swept, in my opinion. There's some graffiti that's been up there now for 2 weeks. And finally, there's trash all along the MTA site on a regular basis. That should be cleaned up every day. It's homeless debris.
Thank you, Jim, and we'll address those items when you, what is your opportunity? Marlene Okulik.
Familiarizing myself with the Brown Act, which I assume it's regards our meetings and our agendas and our discussions being open to the public, people who it affects, it relates to dissemination of information. In the Brown Act, it says, public may comment on agenda items before, during a consideration of a legislature body. Time must be set aside for the public to comment on any other matters under the body's jurisdiction. I interpret this to mean we're allowed to comment before decisions are made regarding raising the dues next year. Any issue that you bring up, the public is allowed to comment for discussion before it's discussed on the board and discussed between us. Another item I am finding out is in your closed session agendas, if final action is taken in closed session, the body generally must report the action at the conclusion of the closed session. Very important. There are many closed sessions. Nothing has been disseminated.
Thank you. John O'Kewa.
Okay. I'm requesting an independent audit of all expenses for 2017 and 2018, since you're keeping everything secret. I'd also like an explanation for what the $468,000 in management fees were used for last year to date. I'm demanding a refund for the 4.5 months of the year of this year's assessment since no services were performed in violation of Proposition 218. There's been no accountability with regard to expenses, especially litigation against the bid and the board. We need disclosure. How much has been spent? Why haven't we been told about lawsuits against the bid on this board? You have disregarded the procedures and timely reports in the contract with the city in violation of that contract. 17 months without services and now $3,000 a day spent on several non-professional strangers patrolling our streets. Where are they? At the Irwin Hotel. Why am I paying for the cleaning of public spaces? The bid cannot govern or enforce rules of public spaces. They have no authority.
Thank you. George Francisco.
Yes. Morning. Morning. I'd just like to make a brief comment to say thank you, because I live in the bid, and it's wonderful to actually see the services cleaning every day on my street. And actually, I'd like to point out that your service staff, and we've been able to say hi a number of times, actually, there was an older, more experienced cleaning person that worked for you, and he'd taken one of the younger people, and he was actually showing him how to scrape off pump skate stickers that had been lining the one-way sign and blocking it. So he actually was taking him aside and teaching him how to make the environment cleaner and safer. I think you guys should know that. It's a credit to you and your guys, and I want to let you know the services have been great, and it's nice to see somebody actually cleaning Venice for a change as opposed to making it dirtier.
Thank you. Okay.
I have one more item just to bring up. That's
okay. Marlene, this is your second and last public comment.
Public comment that doesn't relate to the agenda is, okay. I understand that all the members of the board need to have skin in the game. I'm quoting that from Tara Devine. I understand that there's a member of the board that is not a property owner. All the members of the board, I understand, should be property owners, not assignees, not designees, because they don't have skin. We need to have skin in the game, all the owners. I volunteered myself to be on the board. There was no discussion. I love you, you're great, you're on the board, but there was no discussion about who else wants to be on the board. And after 1 year, those board members need to have, new board members can be nominated. You know, they can burden the work.
Thank you, Marlene. Next item is item 3A, the Venice Beach Bid Safety Team Report. Safe team. Susana, you're up at bat.
Okay, well, good morning, everyone. It's been a little bit short of a month. Tomorrow will be a month since we actually launched. It's been pretty exciting to be here. I don't think we're no longer strangers. We have really made an impact and started to meet a lot of the community, and all the community members have gone up to our team and they've introduced themselves. So I think we're heading in a great direction. I can only give you an overview at this point. It's too soon to give you any real statistical data, but I can tell you that we have tons of calls with towing issues, with people thinking that they're actually, their vehicles have been stolen, but in fact have been towed, because we all know that Department of Transportation is really good at their job. We do things like from helping them make the phone call to letting them charge their phone just so they can make the phone call so they can retrieve their vehicle. So, you know, we've become quite important in that piece. We also have had a numerous amount of recovered stolen items, which they come to us reported to LAPD, and as our officers are going through, they've actually been able to point them out. They call LAPD, they come out, they find them, they identify them, and they've been recovered as well. And terribly, I hate to say it, but we have a high number of lost children. I didn't realize that. I mean, LSPD had said that at one point and they had 100% recovery, but it is in fact true. We do have a lot of incidents of lost children. And it's really interesting to see the dynamics, because the lost children, because that's what they've been informed in school, they go to LAPD or a police officer, a fireman, and they seek help. However, the parents, because they feel like they're gonna be chastised, are a lot more comfortable coming to us and asking us for assistance to find their lost child. So it's turned out to be a 100% recovery. We've had some really serious situations, but they turned out well. The other thing that we have responded to is a numerous amount of disturbance complaints with businesses, and so we have been really active with that. We respond to calls such as noise complaints or loitering or smoking, so we've done a lot of that. And with that said, I mean, if you have any questions or anything, or...
The stolen items, do you have them, or do you have them and then give them to the police?
We do not take anything, we just identify them, the LAPD is contacted, they come and they meet with the owner, and then they resolve it on their own.
What if they don't have the owner?
Okay, so we don't, yeah, that is all...
You just give it to the LAPD?
Correct.
But you won't chase anybody into designated properties if somebody steals something?
No, absolutely not.
Jeff Harris, I know you have a comment on this?
Yeah, I was just curious about the safety, by your schedule. Do you post that some kind of way, or do you just kind of know the schedule?
Correct me, but I believe it's on the website.
Oh, it is on the website, okay.
So, we are currently, we're about just a month into operations, and one of the things that we're starting discussions on, we started with an initial deployment schedule for both the clean and safe team that was based on recommendations from our contractors, Allied and Chrysalis. And so we are about a month in, we're evaluating where our hours are going, et cetera. And I think we are going to make some changes, more so on the safe team side. So we would ask that for current hours of operation, if those are not on the website yet, I'm not positive, but if they aren't, they will be fairly soon, they should be within the next month. And that will always be the best place to check for our current hours of operation. We will change our hours of operation based on need, our calls for service, and we also plan to do some seasonal adjustments for deployment. So the best place to always look for those hours of operation will be the website on an ongoing basis. Whenever we shift, we'll update the reporting.
Okay, and my follow-up was just incident reports, so we can kind of chart what's going on and what you reported lost children. Now, are you going to be, you know, kind of documenting these incidences and maybe trying to figure out ways to combat them?
Yeah, actually, that would be more of an LAPD strategy, I'm pretty sure. Well, I mean, however,
for you guys as a safety team, you guys are almost acting in a diplomatic capacity. So I really expect you guys to be, if you know LAPD, we kind of know their modus operandi, but you guys are for us. So we want to try to make sure that you do something that's, you know, that's tailor-made for the community. Then just have some unique characters, to say the least, which are going to require some real components. Which LAPD, I'm not sure if they're trained for that. You know, if I have a generic approach, you guys have more customized your approach. So I just want to make sure there's ongoing feedback when it comes to situations and how you deal with them, and maybe we'll get some public input on how to deal with them.
Okay, so we do have a documentation process. We have a system called Cyclops that Allied Universal actually owns, and everything is documented through that. So these reports are drawn out.
What is it called?
It's called Cyclops.
Cyclops. Oh, Cyclops.
C-Y-C-O-P-S.
Oh, Cyclops.
It's just the name brand. But everything does get documented on there. So we will be able to track everything and get statistical data.
So these things will be available to the public?
Yeah, that's kind of what I meant.
So keep in mind, folks, we are 1 month into this.
Right.
We are all doing
a heavy... I'd like to talk to her if you don't mind.
We're all doing a heavy lift to get the groundwork in place. So at some point in the near future at our meetings, we'll start presenting some physical reports from the Clean and Safe team. But we are working through some technology issues. We are evaluating whether the current system we're using is really going to meet our needs long term. We are potentially going to look at other systems as well. So be a little patient with us. We will get there. There will be a point in the not distant future where we'll provide physical printed reports at these meetings that will talk about our clean and safe stats. We need a little time to walk before we run. So we are going to do that. It's just not something, we're not quite there yet today.
Thank you, John. Hold on one sec, John. Jim Urez, you're next.
Thank you.
You'll have a chance, John.
We're not allowed to do that now?
John, you submitted a card. Okay.
Yeah, you people.
I'm going to ask for order here.
At meetings, you address your comments to the board, not to the audience.
I don't need your address. Thanks.
Thank you, Jim.
It's my turn to speak.
Thank you.
If you guys are starting out on something new that I think is going to be very positive for the community. One of the things that I recognize, One of the things that I recognize is that you need to do a better job than the cities do. And to that, I would expect you, or at least appreciate it, if you would consider a more transparent solution. Meaning that I would like to have you have some sort of case tracking system, some sort of information tracking system that would track issues, the status of the issue, the date and time of the issue, and any action that was taken on the issue. And I think that should be public information that anybody could go to, so long as it wasn't exposing anyone's individual private personal information. But certainly we want that for statistically to be able to show what we've been able to do over a period of time. I think that this is a fundamental thing. When she talks about what she's doing in the community, it's great. But unless we have reports and data that backs it up on even the slightest issue, that I want an app that I can just report it and have it be tracked.
Thank you. Margaret Malloy.
So I suspect it's incident number one. It's a report from Facebook. We were packed out sitting for a smoke on Speedway in Pacific. A guy approached and asked if we sold crack. My boyfriend said, man, we're artists, we don't do that shit. Another guy was with them, came over to us all puffed up and said, man, you got lip for me. My boyfriend said, no, man, I just don't smoke them and don't know anyone who does. Then he sucker punched my boyfriend and the other guy stepped in to beat him up too. The safe team showed up and got confused and sprayed my boyfriend with mace, continued letting him get beat up. I had to do something, so I stepped in and hit the guy beating my boyfriend the worst. His girlfriend then hit me, so now I'm in a fight with a guy and a girl. It became a total riot. The cops finally got here. My boyfriend has a broken nose. I have a knot on my head from being rammed into a gate. That's your safe team. It's probably the first lawsuit that will happen that I'm aware of.
Thank you. Donna Hewitt.
Okay, I'd like to ask, do you respond to racial incidents?
Do I respond to? Well, you're going to have to elaborate a little bit on that.
Well, the Hotel Irwin, right, I understand, had a racial incident where the guests were asked to, apparently there was an altercation with people staying there that were black, and apparently your people came in response to that, or at least in response to the protests.
Okay, so we responded to
is that what
the
you
crowd
do?
Gathering in front. And we did absolutely nothing but just ask them to stay off private property.
I also understand that the police department's 911 service is many times not functioning. Is it okay with you that you spend $10 million on this ridiculous corporation of yours and that the police don't have the means to respond to people's problems?
John, I'm sorry. So your question about the 911, is it... Okay, so we have gotten a response every time that we have called them. It may not have, but it's like everyone else. It may not be as prompt as we would want it to be. However, we need to note that once we arrive on site, normally most situations get diffused just by our mere presence. So by the time 911 arises, I mean, nothing needs to be followed up with.
And what authority?
None. I don't need to show any authority. I just need to show up in uniform. And normally people just, take it to the next level. They use their own common sense.
The lawsuits that are going to occur from this, $14 million from the woman who was killed. You prepared to handle that? Do you have any excess money for these kind
Thank
of lawsuits?
You, Judge. Thank you, Judge. Adrian O'Donnell.
I'm Adrian. I would just like to make an appointment to look at the last year's expenses that were not refunded. According to the people down at the City Hall, I can ask and it's open to everybody.
Okay, we'll address that during your attendant in your CEO report.
I didn't hear you, I'm sorry.
Tara will address that in her CEO report later.
In her
CEO report. That's another item on the agenda.
At the end of
we'll
the meeting, I typically
we'll
try
we'll
to address the comments that were raised during public
comment. Okay.
Thank you very much. Susana, your team is off to an amazing start, and we appreciate all your efforts. I know it's probably around the clock, 7 days a week, and we appreciate your efforts, and I know the community and stakeholders do too. Okay. Next item is item 3B. It's the bid clean team report. And first, I want to thank Lori, who's done an amazing job with Chrysalis and sort of getting us to where we are today. And I understand you've been promoted to a director position within Chrysalis, and I want to wish you the best of luck in the next chapter. And we all really appreciate all the work you've done in getting us to where we are today. So good luck
in
the next chapter, and make sure to you're always welcome. Turns in.
Absolutely.
Thank you. Okay, Paul, the amazing Paul. Oh, do you want both or both?
You get both.
I already considered your promotion into directorship, but feel free, both.
Okay. I'll start us off, and then Paul can get into more particulars. Okay. I just want to provide an update we really appreciated the positive response we've gotten from the community. We get people coming out of their businesses and thanking us, so we really appreciate that. And so do our crew members. We've been able to offer about 10 new transitional jobs through this contract, so that's exciting. And then we've also had a really great relationship with our city partners. In our last meeting, we talked about how the bid services are a layer on top of our existing city resources. And I think what's neat is that having regular eyes in the district and seeing the needs, for instance, you know, we're able to call 311 to add on to our pressure washing services. We're able to tap our rec and parks department to help us with bulky item pickup. And then a few of our projects that we were working on for our initial blitz, we talked about at the last meeting, we were focusing on weeds, stickers on the signs specifically, because that was a safety concern, not being able to make the signs. And then also our Windward Circle area. So hopefully you guys have seen that impact that we've had. And then as an update too, to the city partnership that we've had, as a second phase to that sign project, for any signs that were too saturated, where it would take us multiple hours, you know, to take those stickers off, or any signs that were damaged or falling over, we were actually able to send that list over to Taylor, and he tapped his contact over at Department of Transportation. So now they're going to be working on replacing those signs. And then, as an update and to address some of your comments, Jim. So the graffiti on Main, so to talk about kind of our graffiti process now, as we mentioned in the last meeting, we've had a soft approach to our graffiti abatement only because we don't want to get into the territory of trying to decipher what's art and what's graffiti. So what we've been doing is receiving calls from the community, and Paul's been really good about making contact with business owners and managers of properties. That way we can check in with them and make sure it's okay. And we also want to make sure we're using, they have a choice of like what paints we're working with, or they can provide their own paint if they want. And then regarding our sweepers and the street sweeping point, I think that's really interesting. My concern would only be that we want to put our best foot forward in protecting like our brand and our presence of our street cleaning. So if anything was to be sitting in the gutters for a while, I would just be concerned about relying on city services, but I think we can definitely talk about that more. What we have been doing in leveraging the street sweeping days is that it gives us really great access to some curb lines, so we can pull up our truck in the pressure wash areas. So we've been working in tandem with that to kind of schedule, you know, our pressure washing hotspots around accessible points because of street sweeping. And then finally, you also mentioned a comment about homeless debris. So that our process for that, and we've had some calls specifically, I think we've had calls just about people having concerns about homeless property. Again, we have to wait for LAPD to respond. They have a process they go through of tagging and informing any owners, so that makes sure that they have time to come claim their items. Then Allied responds, and so we kind of have these checks and balances in place to make sure that we're acting in accordance to the laws around personal property. So I think if you have a particular area, definitely call us, and then we can put you in contact with the proper process to voice that concern. Yeah, I think that's it for me. And then I'll let Paul talk about Tara mentioned, we're working on gathering information, and in the future, we will have more formal reports for you guys. But we did bring some numbers today just to share out with you. So we'll go ahead and do that.
Hello, everybody. So basically, as far as trash bags, Up to this date, approximately 1,300 bags of trash we've already shared before. And that averages out, it all depends on the weekends, but it averages out from 50 to 70 a day on just most normal days. And that includes taking the top layer off of the city cans, looking out for trash cans along the boardwalk. Anything that looks like it might be overflowing, we try to address.
Well, could you explain what you mean by taking the top layer off
okay.
of the city cans?
Well, most trash cans that we deal with have a liner in them with a bag, like you see down on Ocean Front. The city cans that are scattered around that have the big square tops don't have a liner. And I don't really, for safety reasons, expect my workers to, by hand, dig all the trash, you know, out of it. We never know what's in the cans. So generally what we do is, me as a supervisor, whoever's working with me, my driver, whoever's working with them, will lift the lid up and carefully address whatever the top layer is to make sure that more trash can go in the can, nothing's falling out of the can. You know, and like I said, it's just difficult for us to try and dump them because the city has a mechanism that comes and scoops them up into a truck. But we don't want people to walk by and see a can that's overflowing or start sticking trash on the top or throwing it on the bottom. So we generally try to make sure, like I said, the trash can is still accessible for the general public to throw trash into. So that's what we mean by that. As far as bulk items, and that's anything other than bags. Sometimes it could be small items, a microwave oven, you know, pieces of furniture, but approximately 109 different items that we pulled off the street that normally would be there for a 311 call or just sitting there. Larger items, we can try to break them down sometimes and put them into our dumpsters. If we're unable to do that, like I said, we've reached a partnership with Parks and Rec stores. We can call them up. We can get the larger items, take them to a specific location. They'll send a front loader truck over and dispose of those items so that it's not sitting there all week waiting for a 311 call.
Are you guys protected with gloves or masks if you find something maybe contaminated?
Yeah, we have masks. If we have masks, everybody has gloves. And us on our trucks who are handling the other stuff, we do have a different layer of gloves and goggles to make through. Washdowns, I would say approximately 84. Some of those are more frequent than others because it's in some of the main areas, Pacific and Windward, you know, the main areas where the tourists go, around the trash cans in the Windward Circle area, you know, so those are double or triples. If we see things are just terribly stained up, sticky, biohazard spills, you know, we want to address those. Those will be certain areas that we will end up incorporating into a regular pressure washing schedule to make sure that we're getting those. So that's, like I said, that's about 84 washdowns, but some of those are large, some of them are just small. We have taken advantage of the access to the vehicles we have, and we're also trying to make sure that to supplement the city services that down along the boardwalk areas where, you know, it's so important that we get in and pressure wash and clean out pagoda areas around the bases of trash cans, pull the cans out of them to get the loose trash that the city workers don't get when they pull. So that's, and we're doing a lot of that. As far as your concerns on graffiti, the best thing I can say is follow the process. Call. Make a call to the number. As soon as the call comes into the number, the dispatcher, even if it's when I get in the morning, or they're going to call me and say we have a service call, and give me the information and the address, somebody will be, you know, reasonably fast to come over and assess the situation. If it's a particular business, if you have a particular business or a property and you have an issue and concern, give us a call, leave a contact number. You know, I'm going to come over, somebody's going to come over, make contact, make that call. We're here, you know, and you can show me specifically what's going on. When it comes to the graffiti, like I say, it's a lot of people have specific colors on their areas. If we use the graffiti removal on a lot of outdoor paint that's not like an oven coating that might be on dumpsters or metal, what we end up with is a smeared mess. You know, where the graffiti is indistinguishable, but now you have a big stained up section on the wall. So that's why we'll leave that sometimes until we can make contact, find out if you have the paint color, let us know. We'll take advantage of it while we're here. We'll come over, we'll use your paint color, we'll paint it, give you the paint back. If not, we'll have a palette of just basic city colors. Well, okay, you can use this color to cover it up, and then we'll cover it up. And that's also noted for a future reference, so you don't have to continue to call, or we won't have to continue to contact you. We'll know this address right here, we can use lamppost gray or whale gray, and we can just cover that with PDF. A lot of our priority is major public visual areas, you know, where the majority of your people come in, your sightseeing tour buses, everybody gets dropped off, you know, all of your tourists, all of your people are right there. So we try to give that a little bit of priority so that the first thing that they see in Venice and the last thing they see in Venice is not necessarily some graffiti or stained up on the sidewalks. You know, so any questions?
Let me take them. Thank you very much, Paul. Let's take these in this order. Margaret Malloy.
So a couple of things. One is, Mr. Sokol, you've made your livelihood off of the vibe of Venice, which includes large panels of graffiti on your new sixth floor. I love how you're capitalizing on the ethos of Venice, but now you're going to do all this stuff. Sir, if you're topping off the trash cans, you're doing a job the city's supposed to do. That violates the rules of a bit. You know, you're in the most expensive place in town. It violates 218, it violates street and highways. You can't do a job the city's supposed to do. You've just described a job the city's supposed to do. And Mr. Sokol, our main player, is all about graffiti. So, you know, gentleman there with the Sutter property, is that graffiti? Is that gonna be cleaned up? It's been sitting there like that for 10 years. These are issues that need to be addressed. You had more complaints. 311 is a friend of you all. More complaints on that property than any property in Venice. You need to consider these things. Otherwise, it's hypocrisy.
Jim Murray.
Since I raised the graffiti issue. Thank you.
Hold for technical.
Since I raised the graffiti issue, let me just comment that the stuff I was referring to was actually all on public property, street posts, street lamp posts, and signs and trees. When my walk here, there were fire incidents. And that was all on Main Street. I want to reiterate the concept of an information tracking system. Everything that this man just mentioned and everything that this woman just mentioned are all incidents, are all issues, are all things that occurred that they're addressing or that I might be addressing. And if you have an app, that allowed him to take a picture that sent him a GPS instantly, you could start tracking this stuff, and it would make it much easier for the general public, and it would give you the long-term information you need to be able to really show that this is working. Thank you.
Thank you. Harry Shepard.
My name is Harry Shepard, and I represent the homeless population, and a lot of the issues that y'all have seem to be coming from the homeless population. I'm out there 24/7, and I see what's going on. And two wrongs to make it right. The first thing I want to bring up is the issue about having storage units for the homeless to store the property. You know what I mean? Because if we had storage units, it would be all over the boardwalk. You know, and I think it's only right for us to have some kind of relationship between the homeless people and the people we're housing, because the homeless people is what bring the art and the flavor to Venice. You know, without the homeless people, Venice will seem kind of empty. You know what I mean? So I think it's only right for, instead of wasting all this money trying to fight against us to help us, we'll have more storage places where we can store our property. Number two is on the music regulation. I play music, and we have this person named Jason that's on the beach that constantly calls the police in this broad daylight. And we're playing music and we're entertaining people that come down and want to be entertained. you constantly harass and you call the police and you use some kind of law saying that we're not allowed to play music over 500 decibels or whatever.
You can wrap it up.
All right, and number three is harassment calls on Friday when they come clean up the homeless stuff. We take our stuff from the beach and we bring it way up off the beach, and now they are chasing us from the beach and coming wherever we at to get our property. This creates a mentality where the homeless people want to rebel, and you have graffiti, you have junk. People don't care because our stuff is getting stolen. They're telling us that we have to come from Venice to go all the way downtown to pick our stuff up, and when we get down there, our stuff a lot of times is not down there. So all these issues is what's causing this problem, more graffiti, more violence, people getting robbed because of the way they're treating the homeless people. All I have to say.
Thank you. Bill Kuehl.
Yeah, there's an area near where I live that had a graffiti on the sidewalk for a long time. And one of the rocks that was trying to request was me. And they would have all the time to get the power box. And if they were to cut through the job and stand it for the sidewalk, because they're not going to get it off the sidewalk by hand blasting.
We can get to a certain point off of the pavement with the pressure washer that we have, with our solution and both the pressure. Unfortunately, sometimes it's permeated a little too deep into the concrete, and it still leaves a faint trace. And we're limited once again, and what he said earlier about the no parking times, that's something that we have to take advantage of, is whenever there's something on a sidewalk, we need the street area to be clear because of the damage that we could cause to people's cars.
I understand.
If
they were parking.
Yeah,
but
yeah.
The
so,
question is, you're not going to actually clean it if you don't have a safety blaster.
So let me respond to that. I don't know the cost of that equipment, and we would have to take a look at what the cost of that equipment is, whether or not that's something that we would use often enough that it makes sense for our budget. If it does, then we'll look at acquiring that. If it doesn't, then I would look and work with the city to try to find a more efficient mechanism to get them out to address something that we can't. So it's a great note. We'll look into it. I don't know which the answer will be. But we probably can't provide an answer to you today. Thank you for the information, and we'll look into that.
Have you seen the city do that, sandblast?
Yes.
I never have. Okay.
Yeah.
So then that's probably something we can work.
Taylor.
Okay.
Yeah. What's the address? In front?
Oh, it's on the corner of Ennis Place and West Minster, just like down the alley around the corner from your headquarters. Mm-hmm.
Oh, yeah.
You know, which one quarter, like the northeast, right for the 112.
Right across from the Dodge Park on the, with the southwest corner.
Okay. Let's leverage Taylor in the city.
Yeah.
Thanks,
also,
Taylor.
Would you give Quentin your name and number so that we can follow up with you once we've looked into that?
I'm sorry?
Would you kindly give Quentin, raising your hand, your contact information so that we can get back to you? It might take us a while to look into that, but then we can follow up with you.
All right, Paul and Lori, thank you very much. And please thank all the members of your team, too. We really, really appreciate their work. Over 1,000 bags of trash.
1,300.
Amazing. We're making a big difference, and really thank you.
At what cost?
Okay. Next item is item C, the financial report, and that will be handled by our treasurer, Steve Heumann, and Marcus Lieber, CPA. Marcus, I think it would be helpful for everyone here to introduce yourself and talk about your background and experience with business.
I mentioned I work for Armagino. It's an accounting firm throughout Los Angeles. We have an office in West Los Angeles, and I work at that one. We have extensive experience with bid accounting for about 15 years. I personally have been doing bid accounting for over 10 myself. So I've worked on several different bids in the city of Los Angeles. What we really do is help the bid comply with reporting requirements with the city and help with budgeting matters and such, anything to do with financial matters. So it's something I enjoy and am rather passionate about. On an ongoing basis, we help with budgeting, as I mentioned, and on a monthly basis, we prepare typical financial reports, balance sheet, income statement, a version of an income statement that we prepare monthly is a budget versus actual. So you not only see what money has come in and what money has been spent on, but versus what we planned was to be collected for assessments and spent on expenditures for that month and year.
Thank you.
So, you know, I'm going to ask Marcus to take the lead on going through the financial statements to begin this agenda.
Yeah, there's not really a whole heck of a lot to pull out, but I'll just do a simple overview, and if people have questions, we can go there. I didn't want to address the question that gentleman had regarding the review of the 2017 finances. So as a requirement with the contract for the city, the bid is required to do an annual financial review, and that will be done by a third-party firm, not by Armonia, who took care of the books. So, and that review is actually currently being conducted right now by GTO LP, LLP, and that will be available for your review upon completion.
Marlene, hold on one sec. This is how we're gonna handle it. So if you have a question, please fill out a public comment card and we'll be sure to get to you. They're gonna do the reporting first and then we'll get to questions. Okay, so.
Armonino LLP. Armonino.
Thank you. So if you have any questions, please fill out a card. We're glad to take them. Any questions or comments? Okay, go ahead.
Okay. So I believe in your board packet you have a copy of the balance sheet and the income statement, which is that version I spoke of, the budget versus actual. So balance sheet is very typical. It has assets, liabilities, and equity. You can see the cash balance that the bid has. Any liabilities such as a collateral CD that's being held, prepaid expenses, and then we accrue for expenses. So if we know there was a really large expense in May, for instance, but we haven't yet paid for it, we'll accrue for it so we can actually see what expense occurred in that time frame. If you move on to the income statement, the budget versus actual, that's really where your money coming in and money going out is shown. And we'll show what is the actual expenses dispersed for that period and year to date versus the budget for that one monthly period and year to date and any variances. Now the variances, the year to date variances right now are going to be much larger than any individual month variance because the bid just started services last month and the budget goes from the beginning of the year. So really if you look at the month actual versus budget, that's much more relevant, pertinent for our discussion.
Is it a fiscal year?
It is a fiscal year, correct.
And when does it start and end?
So January 1 to December.
It is
calendar year.
Yes. Thank you.
Yeah, that's very typical for this to be the fiscal year in calendar year, correct. The city's year is different, it's split. All right, so if you look at the budget versus actual income statement, you'll see that there hasn't been any funds received by the bid in 2018, but certainly expenditures have occurred. Most of the categories are in line except for repair and maintenance, which there's really a great variance in the one month because of tenant improvements to the newly leased office space. But those are one-time costs, so you won't be seeing that type of variance on an ongoing basis. and also telephone and internet. Same thing, higher variance because it was initial startup equipment costs for telephones, internet. But going forward, it'll be mostly just regular expenses for the use of those services. And because the bid has not received any funds year to date, 2018, it has incurred a loss because it has been spending money on expenses. That's really a good overview of the current situation. Do you have anything to add to that, Steve?
I really don't.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Okay, public comment. Margaret Lloyd.
So I know that there's a lawsuit filed by Mr. Rifkin. The Brown Act is very important and transparency is very important. And you appear to be unable to return almost $500,000 of expenses last year. And I'm quite certain that a lot of that activity that incurred those expenses violates the Brown Act. The city clerk's website has a list of bid consultant referrals. And one of the primary responsibilities of the bid consultant is compliance with the Brown Act. So it's personal, yes it is. I think you're not being guided in the best way. I think you're gonna be susceptible to lawsuits, and I think that that's on everybody's back here because it's incompetence on this side. Maybe you've never run a bid before. Ms. Devine has, but she has not advised any of you in compliance with the Brown Act.
Thank you, Jim Mures.
I don't want to harp too much on the information tracking system that I think However, I think it's the single most important thing, especially when it comes to expenses and transparency. Every single thing that you do has a cost impact. And every single thing that has a cost impact is something I want to know about. I want to know how the details add up. When I hear that the city's not cleaning the streets and the curbs are being, trash is being left behind in the curb, I want to file a fucking action against the city. I paid for that to be done, and I realize that we're increasing the services that they're not doing, but I want to be able to hold it out in front of them that I paid my taxes, and I paid all the business things and everything else they have us paying for, but we're not getting the basic kinds of services. We have no way of collecting that. If he's removing graffiti off of street poles, I want to know how much time is being spent doing that. These are all services that you're providing, and I think we're entitled to know. I think this is really, really fundamental. Thank you.
Thank you. Marlene O'Toole.
I have a few questions regarding this financial statement. Can you point out to me where the salaries are, where the consultants' fees are for this past month or for the past year? And are we going to be told about what there's around? Just very
important. Yeah.
So we have consultants fees under consulting services. They are broken up, some under clean and safe programs, some under district identity and special projects, and some under administration and management. You'll see consulting services as the beginning of the line item. And those would encompass Tara and Clennon to date, I think.
No, just
not just Tara.
And the engineer.
And the engineer. Okay.
Yes.
Is there any way we can break them down so we can see exactly where the costs are? So we can know about what we're paying for. And we can agree or disagree if those salaries or amounts are normal cost of business. And are we going to get the refunds for the first 4 months, 4.5 months of this year, in which there were no services?
Can you repeat your last question? I'm sorry.
Are we going to get the refund, a refund for the first 4.5 months of this year, when there were no bid services? And
so,
if not, what were the expenses for those first 4 months? Exactly. I mean, this gives me approximations. This gives me nothing. And I do accounts, and I do bookkeeping, and I do business.
Let me try to answer your questions. Just looking for detail.
Yeah, let me answer your questions in order. I'm looking for the some details. So, and this is too hard. So I mean, just quite simply, Terrace, including benefits, her pay amounts to $167,000 a year.
How much?
$167,000 a year.
Is that from last year as well, and this year?
That's on an annual basis.
That's payroll taxes, benefits.
That's the gross. That's an annual.
So I don't take that home, no.
No, that's your salary.
That's total compensation package would be the, she probably correct her, including payroll taxes.
Have you been receiving this amount, for the past few years before the bid was enacted?
No.
When did that be?
Nothing last year? Yes, I was paid for it last year.
Yeah, when the bid was approved, that's when that. And your question about, the first months of this year.
Yes.
So the first months of this year will result in a surplus. As you know, and I, you know, don't forget there's a refund coming for last year. And you have, well, for a portion of last year, that's correct. And you've asked for details on last year, and we'll have to get you those details. For this year, because there is no money from last year that we will have. For this year, we did not start services until mid-May. There is a surplus. However, we are also facing other kinds of increases, and we're really going to get into that on the next agenda item when we talk about, you know, basically where we think we're going to be and what kind of assessment increases we're going to have.
So am I correct in stating that $167,000 of the $400,000+ was used towards Terrace salary last year?
No, because I don't think so. I'd have to look, but it's
you're
not
the treasurer.
A full year.
Well, for last year, it started supposedly.
It was less than that for last year. I don't know exactly.
Will we get the information as we are told we should get information, and we haven't received information, and I understand there's a lawsuit pending regarding this information.
So just so you know, in terms of resources, when we get detailed questions like this or questions where we're asked to do a meeting, a budget, and things like that, just be aware there are two staff to deal with all of that. So I realize that you might have an expectation that we convey all information immediately to everyone, and that it's just literally not within our resources.
I'm not saying that.
We do try to respond to everyone as best we can, but keep in mind, you have two direct staff that have to handle it.
I understand.
You can't state your income
Margaret,
for last year?
Margaret, please don't interrupt.
Not off the top of my head, no.
Wow.
Okay, Margaret.
We're running a bit.
Margaret, I'm going to ask you not to interrupt the meeting. You'll have an opportunity when I call on you. Okay.
I just wanted to make an understanding. All last year, you were there were requests, and before the bid began, for transparency and more information, and those emails are open to the public. I've seen them, and I've seen them various times put people off, postpone them, I'll get back to you. And I want to know why you didn't deal with those.
So last year, there was one person handling all requests that came in. Mm-hmm. And I really did try to pay the best attention I could to the most substantive requests. Mm-hmm. It was not possible to respond to everything.
Okay, thank you. Margaret, do you have a final question?
Yeah, is it possible that you don't know your salary for last year?
That's a very basic kind of personal management, and you're managing a bid at $1.8 million, $500,000 plus public money.
Steve, I appreciate you answering, but I asked And I've had a CPRA pending for 2 months. Your only response was, we're overwhelmed. But a CPRA is a state law.
The request is still under work.
You have 10 days to respond and say when I'll get it. Hasn't happened.
Okay,
so,
thank you, Margaret. Thank
these
you.
Are state laws.
Point well taken. Next item is item 3D. We're going to discuss the Venice Beach bid assessment. And to open that up, I'd like to call on Steve Heumann and Kara Devine to discuss.
Okay, thank you, Mark. All right, so under our MDP, you know, to deal with rising costs.
What does MDP mean?
Our management district plan, I apologize. Yes. So we're governed by a management district plan. And under that plan, to deal with rising costs throughout years, we are allowed to raise assessments up to 5% per year. If we want to raise assessments for next year, 2019, we need to do that today, today's board meeting.
The reason for that is the levy must be submitted to the city this month, and it has to go into the assessor the month after. So the city reviews our levy for accuracy, asks any questions, et cetera, and then submits that to the assessor.
Yes, please, if you have a public comment, please fill out a card.
Absolutely.
It'll be handled by card.
So, as everybody knows, we did not raise assessments in 2018, and for good reason. We didn't have services in place. However, and there is a refund happening for 2017, but despite the fact that we did not start services yet, costs were rising, not the least of which is minimum wage. The LA minimum wage is proving to be something that is very tough to contend with, the increase in minimum wage. It went up from 2017 to 2018. In that period, it went up 14 point something percent. This year, in a couple of days, it's going up over 10% again. So that, you know, we are a largely minimum wage driven organization, and that's not to say that everyone earns minimum wage. It is to say that most of the payroll is based off of minimum wage. So we need to be able to retain employees, and we need to pay them a certain amount above minimum wage to retain them. We need to have our supervisors make a little bit more than that, and our lead supervisors a little bit more than that. So when minimum wage is increased, it has an effect, a ripple effect, that really highly affects our entire service provider budget. Not to mention that there are many other costs that are increasing in the economy right now. So, you know, if we look at the 10% minimum wage increase that's happening in a few days, just as a percentage of our clean and safe budget, that's over $135,000 in additional clean and safe costs. While a 5% increase in assessments, it's only going to generate $90,000. So, fortunately, as we talked about previously, the bid does have a cash surplus because we haven't started providing services this year until May. However, based on our calculations, we estimate that even if we increase assessments 5% each of the remaining years, and if we decrease some of our services, including Chrysalis, from 7 to 5 days a week, which is what we have in our contract, we will expend the entire surplus over the remaining initial term of the bid. So I want everybody to, you know, understand that, and I can repeat that. If we increase our assessments 5% each of the remaining years, and we decrease Chrysalis from seven to five days a week, which is what we have in the contract, we'll expend our entire surplus over the remaining initial term of the bid.
What does that mean, initial term?
The initial term means through 2021.
Can we fill out a card too? We'll get them all.
The 5 years?
Yeah.
Adrian, when you fill out a card, write down your questions and comments, and we'll get to them. Thank you.
Yeah, I mean, so. Okay. You know, it's important to note that both of our service providers recommended providing service at a higher level than we were able to agree to because of limited resources, because of budgetary concerns. So, for example, Chrysalis did recommend and does think that 7 days a week is what we need throughout the year, not just for an initial cleanup period. When we started, we wanted to get the district as clean as we could as soon as possible. So we started at 7 days a week, and we are looking for ways to keep it there. But under our contract, in good faith, we agreed to a 5 day week service.
When does that change?
That is something that we planned on for several weeks. And you know, we are looking at what we can do to keep the 7 days going. Some of the answer to that question will depend on what we decide today. So Allied, in addition, recommended several more shifts per week. So we really are, you know, fighting with a tight budget as it stands. Now, on the other side of that, we want to make sure that we're providing services to our district at the levels that are necessitated by the conditions on the street. You know, in my opinion, we need to strive to keep our clean team on the ground 7 days a week, and we need to add more coverage for our safety. You know, in addition, there are other gaps, such as our dispatcher is only slated to be around 5 days a week, and our dispatcher has a direct impact on how well we can provide services. I would like to be able to have our dispatcher 7 days a week, and maybe even expanded hours. So I guess the big takeaway on my initial, before we start discussing, the big takeaway is that our current level of assessments will not sustain our current level of service, much less the levels that we aspire to provide. So, you know, it would be my recommendation that we increase assessments the full 5% this year.
Thank you.
And then we can review that, you know, moving forward.
Thank you. So let's open this up for board discussion and then public comment. First of all, thank you very much for your detailed analysis. I know you spend a lot of time looking at the numbers and very carefully, like the careful business person that I know you are, and I've known you for over 2 decades. So we appreciate that. And I'm going to say, based on my own business experience, costs are increasing everywhere, from minimum wage, which I'm glad that there's been an effort in the city to raise the minimum wage, and other expenses across the board are increasing, insurance, supplies, rent, everything else. I want to make sure that we're able to retain the excellent workforce that we have, and we're looking at a couple minimum wage increases coming up. I'm deeply concerned that if we don't, we'll be in trouble. And we've been off to an amazing start, and we're going to continue to grow and continue to be successful. So I look at the analysis that you've done in terms of the excess, approximately $300,000, and the numbers, it makes sense to me to increase the 5%, which I think is about $90,000 vis-a-vis our entire budget of over 1.8 million, approximately 1.8 million. So that's my thought process, looking at the state of where we are today, the ongoing importance of retaining workforce and continuing to grow and be successful. My position is that we should vote to increase 5%. And I want to open it up for discussion. Another question.
I also appreciate all the work that you guys have done. I'm obviously the newest person on here, there's a lot that I still don't know. I think from a community standpoint, the ask comes at a difficult time because we have just started services. No one's really seen what the impact's going to be, how well it's going to work over the long run. So I think the timing makes it difficult for me to make a decision, and I know there's more discussion. I also really, really appreciate the quality of the people that you guys, we've hired, but you guys have found. And Paul's great, Azusain is great, and we have a really great team. And yeah, I agree, people need to be paid commensurate with what they bring to us. So, I mean, I see both sides, and at the same time, the community is also asking. I mean, and I agree, for more transparency, more results, more communication, you know, developing an app so people can tap into it, none of that comes free or without a time commitment. So I think it's a really difficult question, and I hope we can all be respectful in the way that we address one another about resolving it, because it's tricky. I mean, nobody wants to fork out more money unless we're like, yeah, we really see exactly why this is helping us. So I hope we can talk about it and open it up in a way that we're listening to each other. Because I think, and you know, call me Pollyanna, everyone frequently does that, but I do believe that we all want the same thing. We want a cleaner, safer community. We want people to be respected. We want people to be paid adequately. So I'm a little bit on the fence.
Other comment?
In this first month and in the weeks leading up to that, the language and the discussion with Azusain and with Paul and with Lori has been about establishing a baseline. And establishing a new baseline where, okay, this is the standard we want to have in terms of aesthetics and behavior. And what I would be wary of is if these folks and their teams are putting forth this gargantuan effort to reset a baseline of a neighborhood that has been neglected for half a century, that we would then lose the impetus and have to cut back deployment and cut back effort, which could then lower that baseline, which took great expense to lift in the first place. So in order to maintain what would be the new expectation, because the stakeholders will have the new expectation, people have communicated for months of, we're gonna hold you to a standard higher than the city now,
yeah,
because we've seen what they've done, or we've seen what they haven't done, then I would not want us to trip 2 years from now and go, hey, you know, Paul, it used to be that every month you'd come by and do my block, and now it's been 8 weeks. What's the deal? And him having to say, well, I'm at 4 days a week rather than 7. So in order to support them in establishing a new baseline, I think it's very reasonable to ask for the 5% annual increase to continue to allow them to raise it and then maintain it through the length of the contract.
Okay. Having known that we had that capacity, it always seemed to me that we would always exercise asking for it, because I've never seen things get cheaper except during severe catastrophic depressions and recessions when nobody is working. And so commensurate with income, it tends to be, you know, if costs drop, income drops, and they tend to go together. So my expectation of costs are going to go up. I wonder, a couple of things strike me. I think that there are people amongst the paid stakeholders that are not going to take their refunds. I expect there's a population of those people out there that I've already heard from and talked to that don't have any interest in taking the money back, but would rather see it deployed for any surplus we need. I know that when we started out there, and I think Paul could speak to this, I think the SAFE team can speak to it very clearly. There is a lot of inertia to overcome in this community from an absolute, the oversight neglect of years and years and years. I suspect health returns quicker when you're not contributing to the sort of degradation of the organism. And my suspicion is that we're gonna start gaining some momentum that we can't quite predict yet, and that we're, our efficiency and our ability to deal with the issues will start to eliminate a lot of the issues simply because the psychology of people coming down here don't see trash everywhere, so figure that they can just throw whatever they have wherever they want. And people, kids I know, don't want to spend time shoplifting spray paint or paying for it and not have their graffiti remain up. And when they see that start to disappear quickly, they tend not to repeat it. So I think we're going to have a reduction of the stuff that we're all so used to. Whether it goes away, or, I think there's always going to be management, but I think those are wild cards in all this, and things that we can't quite predict yet. So I still think having the money available is important. I think maintaining, I think paying people for what they do is important. I think we're a community that has social responsibility and is aware of it, and I don't think trying to underpay people and ask them to do more is any more than the city's asked us by asking for our taxes and then underserve their responsibility and commitment to us to force us to even create this to begin with to try to make up some of the shortfall. I also think that our obligation is to liaison with the city and start to increase their understanding of what needs to be done so that what we're doing can lessen over time rather than be a chronic sort of subsidizer and enabler of the city's deficiencies. And they have proven very often what they're willing to do down here. They've gotten better, I have to say. There's been a lot of steps forward, a lot of communication, a lot of activity. But if we're out there doing the work that sanitation should be doing, or street maintenance, then I think we should talk to them and say, look, these are things in your lap that we could pull back on and start to actually apply ourselves in ways that are much more productive, and maybe not have to apply ourselves at all. I don't want to see any of the people who are employed and doing this great work unemployed, but I also know that our purpose is not to simply employ and grow like a bureaucracy within a government that tends to grow despite me. I think ours is, I would love to put ourselves out of business by being so good that we could get things running down here the way it should have been, rather than the way it's been. So nevertheless, I'm very much in support of doing what we need to do to be sure that we have the resources to get done what we have in front of us.
Yeah, thank you. Any other comments, Jake?
I do want everyone to understand, as a restaurant owner, and we have upwards of 90 employees in the summer, and you think how many of my employees are minimum wage and how much is that going to affect? The minimum wage has effects far-reaching, not just at the lowest level. So it had ramifications throughout my whole restaurant. Employees that worked in 20, 30 years were affected by minimum wage going up because of this cascading effect. So I do, I think everyone should understand that it's not just the lowest people, it's just above the lowest people, it's the people who've been there, and the better people you've got to pay over minimum wage, or you're not going to keep them because they're going to work in some place that's less hard to work than Dennis. So, I mean, that's been my experience, and it's a good thing for everybody, but it makes it hard to deal with.
Thank you. So, go ahead.
I just wanted
to say to Jack, you know, I absolutely hope that we are able to find efficiencies and that our positive impact reduces the need for our work, and I am hoping on for that. And in fact, it's something that I think could allow us to provide just what we want to provide, despite, you know, budgetary concerns. And so, you know, when I just put on my treasurer's hat and look at the numbers, it's one thing, but when I think of it, you know, just as a county representative, I'm thinking, yeah, this is an awful time to make this ask. But, you know, and maybe we can reduce our, you know, we can put ourselves out of business. And so maybe in future years, we won't have to increase that 5%. But I know that at this juncture, as you said, it's really something that has to happen. And just another quick side note, you know, we specifically organized as a 501c6, so that we could discuss with the city, hey, you need to do this for us, you need to do that for us. We didn't want to just provide service without being able to address issues from a perspective of being able to put our two cents in with the city. So a 501c6 allows us to lobby, put our, you know, opinion out there, and really go after city services more than, say, just a regular 501c3 nonprofit.
I would just like to add, I don't know if this might be informative for some of you. I know that familiarity with the minimum wage and what's going on with it may vary amongst the crowd. But just to give you an idea, I think what we've been looking at financially, and I understand that considering we had the late start, it may seem counterintuitive to ask for more money. What we're looking at is the cumulative impact over the next, over this year and the next 3 years. And so it's important that you understand our limitations. We have one opportunity to consider an assessment increase at this time of year. And according to our management district plan, the maximum we can increase is 5%. So we have that, we have one shot each year to increase, and that is our only shot. And the reason for that are the logistics of placing the assessments on the tax rolls. So that's kind of our limitation. We don't have a choice in that matter. That is what it is. What we're looking at is the fact of the cumulative increases of the minimum wage. Roughly about 80% of our budget is labor or labor-related costs, like payroll, et cetera. So from last year's increase in the minimum wage was a 14.3% increase. This year's is 10.4. Next year's is 7.5. And the following year is 5.3. All of those numbers range from nearly three times to the same as the maximum we can increase. So I think one of the things that is important to understand is that we're looking at our budget not just for this year, we're looking at the budget for the remainder of the term of the bid. And if we do not increase assessments this year, we're very concerned about the later years of operation and deep cuts to services later in that term. Is that helpful for context? I thought it might be.
Any other comments or questions from board members?
I do think too that I agree, Jack, that we could find efficiencies and we could find better deployments of city services. I also think there will be, I think, interesting conversations to be had, like the gentleman that was talking about the sidewalk graffiti, or, you know, Paul and I have already been talking about. So Jose really would like an industrial paint sprayer so that he can just do the gate at the request of the property owner with the property owner's paint color and then go. So a hour-long job becomes 10 minutes. So I think there will be interesting logistical discussions to have of, you know, I think we really want to invest in that piece of equipment. I think that would be something that would really, you know, we buy a $3,500 top-of-the-line industrial paint sprayer and it cumulatively saves labor hours so that we can employ better. So I'd like us to have as much potential surplus as possible to allow for the logistical conversations that could help everybody better.
That's great. And that's not the only equipment request we're considering that was not part of the original proposal.
Right.
So we're looking at a couple of things like that that could improve efficiency, that could improve the safety or well-being of our teams, et cetera. So there are a number of items we're looking at now that we have a month of experience under our belt. Our teams are advising us based on their actual field conditions. And there are some things like that that we'd like to be able to do. Some of them we think would be really worthwhile investments.
And granted, this is a terrible time. As Connie said, this is a terrible time to, you know, 1 month in to have this conversation. I would, you know, much rather wait till the end of the year when we know more. But as Tara, you know, put much more eloquently than I did, we need to take an action today to safeguard tomorrow. And we can always, next year, we will, of course, revisit this every year, and we will be able to, you know, take what action, whatever action is necessary with that additional knowledge that we'll have after another year of operation.
And I do think that the board has already shown good faith in agreeing and actually driving a refund. So it isn't like, I mean, I absolutely hear you when you say and believe that we will look at it each time and not like, oh, it's gonna be automatic. I mean, I appreciate that as a resident. And so thank you for that.
Thank you. Any other, Steve?
No.
Okay. So before we go to public comment, and thanks everyone for your valuable input and questions and comments, is there a motion to increase assessment 5% in
2019?
We're going to go to public comment.
Before the vote.
I'm going to raise a
before
question.
Before the vote.
Absolutely. Please don't interrupt me. We're going to go. I'm asking the question.
You're breaking the law.
And then we're going to public comment.
Why don't we?
I'm going to ask the question and then go to public comment. Okay. Like I said, is there a motion to increase assessments 5% in 2019?
So, I guess my question is, do we need to wait until after public comment to make that motion and vote on it?
We're going to have public comment. I'm going to ask for the motion and then open up the floor to public comment.
Let me help provide some advice here. From the audience's perspective, I would say it might behoove you to listen to one or more motions. So what can happen in a meeting, you might have competing motions here. You might want to comment on those motions. So we are going to hear public comment before there's a vote on any of them.
But the public comments should influence the vote.
Excuse me 1 second. Jeff Briggs, are you here?
I'd like someone to call to
I'd like to recess for 3 minutes, 3 to 5 minutes, and talk to
and Jeff figure Briggs out the law?
And our general counsel. So we're going
to
have a recess for 5 minutes to discuss the matter so that we handle this procedurally correctly. Okay? So we're going to recess right now, and Jeff, I'd like you to come up.
It's an expensive process. I need a lawyer to decide if they have a public comment.
I have Brown Act here with me, if you'd like to review it.
Connection.
Unless it's some person that's got a word,
And don't forget there will be the.
Okay, let's recommit. Okay, so this is what we're going to do procedurally. So if there's a motion can be seconded, and then it will be open to public comment. If the motion isn't seconded, then the motion dies. So that's procedurally how this is going to be handled. And at this time, I'm going to make a motion, and is there a second, to increase assessment to 5% in 2019.
I have a question for you.
I second.
Okay. Motion is seconded. We'll now open the floor to public comment. If you have a public comment and you haven't turned in a card, please do so. First public comment, Sean Berry.
I'm here.
Thank you, Sean.
I'd like to thank you guys for all you're doing. We appreciate it. I do have some concern. I own commercial property for a living. I realize the need for, you know, a clean area for people to do business. I do not own any commercial property within the bid.
Excuse me.
The conversation at the back of the room is making it hard to hear the public speaker. It could be resolved better take it outside. Thank you.
I'm a residential property owner within the bid. My concern is, you know, is there going to be a concerted effort to make sure the services are, you know, provided equally in the residential areas as well as on the boardwalk, because that seems to be where the greater need is. And, you know, is it prudent to have an increase in fees, you know, when we're just getting started, you know, at this point? My concern is, you know, you always meet a budget, you know, or you always meet, you know, what your possible, you know, income is. So it's going to be easy to, you know, spend more money, you know, rather than save money.
Thank you. John O'Kewa.
Okay. Well, I'm incensed by this whole thing here. There's 17 months of no benefits to the property owners. This increase is ridiculous after 1 month of services. What do you think, the businesses in this city don't have increases also? Why don't you reduce your services instead of dumping it on us? There's no leadership here, there's a lack of leadership, and I would really like to see Ms. Devine taken off this committee as CEO. She's terrible. She's incompetent, she has not provided any services. She's arrogant, she has not given us information that we requested. And I'd say, if you're all concerned about the cost, why don't you all forego your refunds? I think that would be a good first start. Why don't you vote on that? Give up your last year's payments. She's in violation of all the contract with the city. She's in violation with the Brown Act. It's just unbelievable how incompetent you people are. Maybe with exception of Connie. asking us to increase our cost to you for what?
Thank you, Margaret Malloy.
Yeah, I'd like to say, with irony that I hear you say how conscientious you are and how concerned you are about uplifting the community, you know, there's several people operating in violation of their certificates of occupancy. I'm pretty sure your own office violates the certificate of occupancy. It's a change of use, change of intensity of use, no parking. This whole thing is just like fundamentally flawed. It's doomed to fail, I would say. And the CEO making $187,000 for a year while we're discussing minimum wage for people doing really challenging and important work. I appreciate intensely Chrysalis and your services. I'm fundamentally opposed to all of this. You have 90 employees over the summer. Where do they park? I really want to know where they park. John and Marlene have none. You know, how is this equitable? How do people with residential properties gerrymandered into your area have any kind of equity in the in this process? 90 employees?
Thank you.
Thank you. Adrian O'Donnell.
I would just like to know the procedure. What how does this work? Do you want to increase our taxes by 5%? What's the procedure? What do you do? You have a meeting and you guys vote on it and then it goes through, or you have to go to the city or we vote again? What's the procedure? I would like to know that.
Okay, so we'll get to that. Is there any other public comment on this matter? Please fill out a card.
I did.
I didn't get it. Okay. Okay. Margaret. Go ahead. I'm sorry, Marlene.
First of all, everyone deserves a living wage. The minimum wage being raised is a long time coming. And we've been asking for it for a long time. People deserve to live comfortably. I know that all the people on the board, or most of the people that are property owners, they're wealthy people. They don't. That 5% means nothing. This 5% is compounded over 5 years. So it's not 5% each year. It's 5% compounded. Also, Steve, you mentioned there's a surplus each year. What's wrong with spending your surplus on the additional costs that are coming up? That you say that are coming, you don't know what they are. We don't know what they are, but I'm not getting a raise in anything that I do. And the people that are giving back their monies, what's wrong with them, you know, using that money towards the services that you say will be costing more? I don't get where it's coming from, and I vote against that, because we don't even know where the $400,000 went from the year that the bid wasn't even in service. And until we know that, how can we vote for something?
Thank you.
Services to be included. Increased.
Thank you. Okay, Tara, no. And then we'll open it up for more discussion. And
so in terms of procedure, I alluded to part of it earlier, which is the bid is responsible for furnishing an annual levy to the city clerk's office. The city clerk's office reviews that document for accuracy. We have a dialogue if there are any things that they have questions about, and then the city clerk submits the final levy to the county assessor. In order to be placed on the tax rolls, the levy has to be to the assessor by August 1st. So as we alluded to earlier, we do not unfortunately have the luxury of waiting till later in the year to make this decision. We understand those concerns that have been raised. I think every single member of this board would probably agree with you that the timing is not ideal. We wish we had more service time and more information to give you to help you understand why we're making that decision. We are working towards providing all of that information as quickly as we can, while also running operations, while also dealing with general public inquiries, while also filing the reports that are required of us, etc. So it is a prioritization process. And we are trying to prioritize the things that we hear the greatest amount of feedback from you on. And I hope that you've seen that. The assessment issue is one of them, et cetera. We're trying to hear what are the areas of greatest concern to the most people who are participating in our process and respond to those. We're prioritizing those.
If you go from the board
will decide, and then the board communicates with the city.
So, yeah, so
doesn't
the board takes it
at us at all.
So the management district plan has a provision in it that allows the board each year to make a decision on whether or not to increase assessments up to 5%.
It's private citizens that are raising our taxes.
Okay.
That's right.
Please don't interrupt, Tara.
So that authority rests with the board under the MVP. We do agendize it every year. We have a public conversation like this, and we have a public vote. And we report to the city the board's action on this item. So that is how the assessments are either kept same or increased up to 5%. Okay.
Thank you. So, Marlene, I see that you had one other question. Please go ahead.
Why don't you use your surplus?
So we are going to use the surplus. I don't know if I made myself clear, but the surplus that exists from there is no surplus from 2017. The money, we will get less in 2018 to the tune of the 2017 refund. So then, however, there is a surplus in 2018 because we didn't begin providing services until May. That surplus will be, over the remaining term of the bid, that surplus will be more than eaten up, or eaten up at least, even with increased assessments and decreased services. Okay, so we absolutely are using the surplus. We expect that more of it will be eaten up later rather than sooner, but we need to plan for the entire term.
But you mentioned that you're going to be more efficient in your services, and you mentioned that you're going to probably need less services. And since we all as individuals need to work within a budget, I don't understand why you can't work within a budget, because you're getting up $2.8 million a year. It seems to me with 1.8, excuse me, but that 1.8, it seems like you could figure out how to do it without raising
our taxes. Up to 5% increase is within our budget. It is part of our management district plan. It is an option that we have. So that was part of the development of the budget, was that consideration. And again, I can't reiterate enough that our financial outlook and the reason for the assessment increase is not based predominantly on this year, it's based on future years. It is a concern about cumulative effect. And so what we're looking at, we are certainly looking at efficiencies in operations. We're looking at opportunities for equipment to replace some labor and put some more labor out there to do more things better and faster. But those are a lot of things that are unknown at this point, not fully able to quantify. What we will be able to do is by next year, when we're considering an assessment increase, we'll have a lot more data to be able to quantify those.
And why also to speak, now?
One moment, let me respond to the questions you already asked, please. Mm-hmm. So you also asked about people giving back money. Mm-hmm. We have heard a few property owners who would like to return their 2017 assessments. Mm-hmm. We cannot, from a fiscal perspective, count on that money until it is received. Again, that is something, if received, we will account for next year, but that is theoretical money. That's not money that we can budget or put in a contract for our vendors. That's not money that we can purchase equipment with. That is imaginary money until it's money that we've actually received.
You know, I want to also say, you know, the reason that that is in the MVP, the reason the city, I think, has that language in there, is to account for the fact that costs go up over time. Now, our costs will be, you know, will go up a lot more than that because of minimum wage. Minimum wage is the increases, while I believe in them and I think they're the right thing to do, it does have a overwhelming impact on the services that we can provide. That's why we're having this discussion. And as I stated before, you know, we, for good reason, we did not raise assessments in 2018, but If you look at the cumulative effect of not raising assessments just that one year, it can be as much as, if we raise 5% every year as opposed to every other year, but not that year, there's a $400,000 difference there. So we're not talking about small amounts of money. We're talking, you know, and whereas the 5% increase over our entire budget is $90,000. So, you know, we are not happy to be making this decision today, and we're not happy that we have this need, and we hope that we won't have the need in the future. And what happens in the future, those efficiencies that we hope we will, you know, arrive at or have, will inform our next discussion. And if we have extra money, we can return money. There's nothing saying we can't do that.
Hold on a sec. We'll get to you. Let's wrap up your questioning, and then Steve, budgeting. We can talk about budgeting. Probably a minute.
But if you don't have enough money to pay these bills to these people here, who pays for that?
John,
what's the budgeting question?
Yeah. Marlene, would you clarify your question?
What's wrong with working within a budget that you were given initially when this started? Because we can't even account for the $400,000 that we spent for the first 12 months that we don't even know what we're accounted for, because my brain thinks, well, you can't even work within a budget. If you spend $400,000, that kind of upsets me. It does upset me a little bit. Where'd the money go? Why are you going to raise it from where, ask for
we're
more money?
We're going to give you the details of where that money went.
Uh-huh.
We are working within a budget. We have a budget that we submit to the city. We're working within that budget. The city understands, and I already said this, but the city understands the costs go up over time, so they increase your budget. You know, if I had to live on what I made 5 years ago, it would be a lot tougher. If you look at most workers, if, you know, costs go up, wages go up. It's the same for a business. You know, we have to increase menu prices to keep up with increased food costs and increased labor costs. It's, that's why the assessments need to go up.
For the corporations, you're just failing.
Okay. Thank you. Margaret?
Yeah, the gentleman who left was a CPA. I'm quite sure that he made the statement that there's a deficit this year because of the expenses of retrofitting the property that's your office. And you're saying there's a surplus, and, you know, there's no accountability, and it's just, it's pretty amazing. The arrogance to sit here with a relatively straight face and say, after approval on November 9th, 2016, we've produced 1 month of service, but actually the first week was sort of a kickoff week, wasn't even on the radar. So 3 weeks of service effectively, and now it's time for increase.
Okay.
I'm asking a question. Did that gentleman? Yes, please. Thank you.
Let's see if we can move on after that. What he was referring to is a deficit in one particular account on the books for repair and maintenance, and that had to do with tenant improvements that we made to our office. So he was simply looking at what we have budgeted for repair and maintenance throughout the year compared with, or monthly, on a monthly basis, compared with what we spent in May on that category, that expense category. So it's more than the budget, because we had to do tenant improvements, and we included that in the repair and maintenance line item.
There was one other instance
where Marcus used the term deficit, and it was in the context of, if you look at the income statement, what he was referring to is the fact that we have no income from this year. And that exists only because we received money in 2017 this bid board voted to refund assessments from 2017. To simplify the process, the city clerk is issuing those refunds out of the 2018 revenue that they still have in their possession. So Marcus used the term deficit to refer to the fact that this year we have no income, and that is the reason why we don't have income this year.
Chair and Steve, is it okay for me to address the tenant improvements?
Sure.
Okay, just so you know, the tenant improvements that were done into the office space were all done to make our office space safer for every person that's working in the office that comes in and out. We had an unusual floor plan that we were dealing with, and there weren't handrails on stairs for transitioning. We had, you know, items that were just added to make sure that any of our workers, any of the public that comes in, can walk in and be safe. We didn't want anyone to be jeopardized because the space had some unusual places where people could have tripped and fallen. And so those were the items that we wanted to address. Safety was number one priority. Aesthetically, they might not be the prettiest of improvements.
The landlord was not able to provide those for you?
They did help us to a degree, but there were plenty of issues that they did address. But some of these other issues, we had to bear the cost. And so it was all to keep the space as safe as possible. Like I said, aesthetically, it's not pretty. There's no way around it because we really try to do the best with everybody's funds and to, again, to make sure it's a very safe office.
Thank you. Well,
The question was, did you get permits for the work?
Hold on a sec.
That's the question.
Marlene has a question.
I understand that you're under litigation and there's lawyers and there's lawsuits. How are you paying for these lawsuits? Are they coming from your bid funds?
Yes.
Okay.
The question was, are there permits for the work that was done?
The question is that.
Can anybody answer the question?
Hold on, Margaret, you're talking at her.
I can share. So in 2018, just for the law firm that handled our litigation with you, we paid roughly $93,000. However, if you include the 2017 fees, the litigation cost us $172,000.
And for those members who are not aware, this was a lawsuit instigated by a small number of property owners within our district. We did not have a choice in whether or not to respond to it.
This current litigation that's going on now, that I understand.
And in that litigation, we were successful. The judge ruled in our favor on all counts in the litigation.
Can you answer my question, please?
We're going to move on.
No, I asked a question.
The question you asked is
Did you have permits for the improvements?
Margaret, I'm going to ask you one more time. And not to interrupt the meeting, and if not, you're going to have to leave the meeting. So you're interrupting the meeting. You're asking, you can discuss it afterward.
Just for clarification, there's a total of $172,000 spent for the past litigation.
Spending your litigation, yes.
For the current litigation, I understand there's a current.
I don't believe there's any money spent.
That's correct. Okay. So with that, thank you for the public comment. And before I call the vote, I want to open it up again to the board discussion on the 5% increase. Are there any other comments on the matter? Anything else? Before I call the vote.
Again, I think it's unfortunate that we have to make a decision today, but I do think that for many reasons we've discussed, not the least of which is the minimum wage increase, that we will need this current 5%, and should we later find that further increases are not needed, we don't need to
do that in the future.
Thank you. Any other?
I think that if we are to be fiscally responsible, we need to be prepared, we need to know that things are probably not going to go as well as I hope for them. And hope has never proven itself more assured in my experience than the numbers, so, you know, I think it's something we need to do regardless of how it appears and what the time is.
Thank you. Any other comments on this side? Okay, so let's take the vote. So does the board approve the motion to increase assessments 5% in 2019? All in favor, raise your hand. Okay, so it's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 in favor and 1 opposed.
Or abstain.
Abstain, okay. Is it abstain or opposed?
Okay, then to these people.
Do you want to let's finalize that so we have a vote?
I'll say no.
Okay, all right. 5 in favor and 1 against, so the motion passes. Okay, so next item is number 4, the CEO's report. Karen.
Hi. Go back to my notes. I'm going to skip over a few comments that were addressed by Lori and Lori or Paul in regards to some of the services. We also had several people ask questions. Let me try to run through them as quickly as possible. As mentioned, we are currently undertaking our financial review for 2017. When that's available, we will make that available. We have addressed the litigation and those costs. Board makeup, I'm going to address just very briefly. If you'd like a copy of our bylaws, I'm happy to provide them to you. We are in compliance with our bylaws.
Are not property owners allowed to be
on the board? Continue.
Jim asked a number of times about an information system. So, yes, one of the things that we are grappling with is how to capture data. We share the view that that is incredibly important. It informs us in the most rich way possible about our services, about our deployment, et cetera. Now, there are a couple of existing tools out there. Our security vendor has one that they use for their services. We are evaluating that, we're using it and evaluating it. One of the things that we'll be discussing over the next couple of months is whether or not we think that system is adequate, whether we want to look at other systems and start to talk to others about systems that we can develop. So I would say that is certainly our goal, to produce as much data as possible and to be able to provide public or property owner access to that data. But that is a huge undertaking. That is a substantial plate of work. That is a substantial a job or task. And it's also also potentially money. So we have to take all of those into account. As I said, I think what you're going to see is that in the very near future, we'll start producing some reports. Those will increase in quality over time. And I think, just to speak to Jim, kind of in what he raised, the level of data that he would like and sort of an app where you can report problems on your phone, et cetera, that is a substantial undertaking. That won't be happening tomorrow, but that's something that if you can find the room within the budget, I think we'd eventually like to do. But realistically, that is probably, you know, that's a next year item, not a 2018 item, just in terms of what goes into putting something like that together. One thing I will say about this board, and I know that some of you may disagree with the speed with which we establish operations, yeah, but I will say that this board undertakes a level of due diligence that I have not seen in any other board I've worked with. And I will say, when you do that level of due diligence, it's not as fast. It's not as fast. But I think one of the things that you'll see with this board is that they have a lot of confidence in the decisions they make, and that's because we take the time to really look at these things.
Their confidence.
So when we undertake a contract, we look at multiple vendors, we really do our research, we talk to other people in the field, we check references. All of those things do add up to time and effort. So that's a balancing act, and we choose conscientiousness and diligence.
topping off of cans. So specifically, Margaret, to your comment, I respectfully disagree with your characterization. We are a complement to city services. Us taking the trash off the top of the can is not replacing the city service. The city still comes along and empties it. Our goal in taking the top off the trash can is to avoid the situation that I know I used to see all the time in Venice, which is overflowing trash cans on the sidewalk. The city still comes by and picks that up, but we take the top off of it so that you don't have it spilling out onto the sidewalks, getting kicked into the curb, creating a mess, getting spread out, having people walk through it, etc. So that is a supplemental service to the city. The graffiti on poles that Jim mentioned, not knowing the specific ones that he was talking about, I would say, again, I go back to the fact we're prioritizing graffiti and sticker removal from street signs first, because we feel like navigation is a major issue. It's not just aesthetic, it's also safety. So that's a first priority. You will still see some street signs out there that have stickers or graffiti. Odds are, those are ones that are either a bit more labor and we're gradually working on those, or they fall into the bucket of the list that we furnished to the city that we're asking for repair or replacement. So it is our hope that you will cease to see street signs with those things on them over the next few months, but there is a process that will go into that. And then there is, of course, in this district, a lot of graffiti and stickers, street poles and light poles and dumpsters and trash cans, etc. The amount of labor to remove all of that, again, that's a long-term project. We will steadily work at that. But again, we chose a specific area to focus on first, and we will continue that. So we try to be strategic about our resources and try to get, try to tier these things so that you see impacts in the most important areas first, and then we can keep making passes at this. So there will, we are not at the baseline that the bin wants to be at, not even close. We're continuing to work towards establishing that baseline. I unfortunately, he is not here, but I was personally very empathetic towards the gentleman who talked about storage units for the homeless having to go downtown. I do have some familiarity with the facility that is downtown, and which is, I believe, run by the city. It is a great service. It's an amazing service. It's located in Skid Row. Folks can go in and voluntarily check in possessions and renew their storage bin every week. And then it's also a place where the city or others can take belongings that they've picked up, and then people can go retrieve them. It would be lovely if we had a facility like that in every major neighborhood in Los Angeles. Today we don't. That is an expensive facility to run. It's a difficult facility to site. That is something, ongoing topic of discussion in the community, that's a bit larger, perhaps, than what the bid can undertake. The sandblasting we kind of addressed. That's something we can certainly look into, the cost of that equipment, whether or not we think that's economically feasible for the bid, or if it makes more sense to, because we're removing a lot of things that perhaps the city otherwise might, see if we can get the city to come out and deal with that ingrained graffiti that's on the sidewalk. So we will look into that. Change of use for our office, that is really fundamentally our a landlord issue, but our landlord has appropriate documentation to demonstrate that our use is allowed. One thing I did say at a meeting some months ago, and I will say again, and I don't say this lightly, but we currently do receive more inquiries, complaints, small requests, in terms of like general inquiries as opposed to our clean and safe inquiries. We do receive more than we can respond to. So my direction
to our staff is to respond first to those issues that affect the greatest number of the people paying our assessments. So the broader the issue, the more we hear about that issue, we try to respond to it. We're also looking through our communications program and our website to try to progressively put more and more information on the web so people can help themselves to that information rather than emailing us and us having to do that work repeatedly on a one-off basis. So I will admit there are probably some inquiries we have not responded to. We do try to respond in some way to just about everything, but the level to which we can respond to some of them varies, and we will always prioritize the things that we think affect the most.
Thank you. Okay, so there's two public comments. Margaret Malloy.
Okay, so in terms of the property where you're renting, a change in intensity of use requires a CDP. I expect you all to know that. Jack's a realtor, he could be your consultant on that. The city argued, we feel that the area of city property was gerrymandered to give the city this 47% vote into the bid in the petition phase and 47% of the yes ballots to form this bid. It is actually. The city argued that the boardwalk is a city park under Parks and Recs for the sake of certain funding and controls, including the inclusion in the bid and the allocation of those general funds. Yet when a $14 million lawsuit for the death on the boardwalk of an Italian tourist and two others that were injured, the LA Times quote, city lawyers have tried to fend off such lawsuits by arguing that the Venice Beach boardwalk fell under a state code that relieves government agencies from legal liability for injuries on recreational trails. The boardwalk, they argued, is used to access the beach and nearby bicycle path and recreational activities, such as a handball court and volleyball court.
Comments.
We have other comments.
Okay.
The appellate court rejected that. You will be liable, and please take that to heart.
Thank you, Marlene. Our last public comment.
I just wanted to state and understand and agree that next year that we will have 172,000 in surplus.
Well, I think the best thing to do will be to see what the surplus actually is.
Well, you will have, you would have $172,000 to spend on something else that you didn't spend on.
I have no idea how you got that number.
You gave it to me, I just wrote it down.
She's counting the court costs.
The
court costs are more than
Is that correct?
I think the answer to that would be we had to find that money in this year's budget. It was not budgeted for writing. So that is an example of a cost that we've incurred that falls into the category of extraordinary events. And that cost was a hit to our budget overall.
So you agree that you will have 170,000.
You're equating apples and oranges. And I'm not going to say yes to that.
We can talk more about
that. Let's talk about that after. Let's talk about that after. Right, another time.
Money is money.
Okay. I want to thank everyone for attending here today. We appreciate it. We appreciate your time. Big thank you to Shannon for coming out from Sheila Kuhl's office. We do a good job of leveraging services of the county, and thank you for coming out. We look forward to seeing you here in the future. Taylor Baisley, as always, thanks for all your dedicated efforts to making Venice a better place. We appreciate all your time, and you've worked amazingly with Paul and Chrysalis to provide city resources where they weren't being provided before. For example, I think you said there were 50 to 90 signs that are getting replaced. A lot of signs are getting replaced. Thank you for working in conjunction and in partnership with us. Thank you, everyone on the board, for your time and thoughtful comments and input. It's a privilege to work with and on this board with people that are as thoughtful and diligent and wise as people on this board. Steve Heumann, our treasurer, thanks again for your analysis and the time you put in. And they put in a lot of effort and time to prepare for today and to be able to make that recommendation regarding the assessment. Tara, your work ethic continues to be unparalleled. And I know this entire board and the state. stakeholders appreciate it because we're seeing results. So thank you very much for all the time that you put in. You go above and beyond, and we appreciate it. And finally, our service providers, Susana, our safety team, you've done an amazing job leading the team and providing services that are beneficial to the community. I know that your efforts are appreciated by our stakeholders, and we appreciate all the time and dedication that you put in. And in training the team, and I know our team cares a lot about the community and the stakeholders in the district. And Paul and Chrysalis, thank you very much for everything that you do. Your attention to detail is amazing. The employees too, the people out in the field. I'm really impressed with their care for this neighborhood. And they came in from day one and showed amazing care. And Lori, thanks for everything. Thanks for all your time, and best of luck to you in the next chapter at Chrysalis. We hope to see you again. You're always welcome. All right, so with that, it's 12:10, and this meeting is adjourned.